Good morning. This is Sunday, November 7th. It's All Saints Sunday and the 24th Sunday after Pentecost. And if you didn't turn back your clock this morning, it's the second hour you're sitting here waiting for us. Bless your heart. I greet you now with these well-known words. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Listen now to this call to worship. Come and worship the one who wants your all. We come to worship the one who offers all. Come and worship with all your heart and soul and mind and strength. We come and offer all that we have and all that we are in worship and in service. Come and be blessed and pour yourself out in worship. We will worship wholeheartedly and with joy. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning is, Father, we praise thee, and listen for the word saint in all of our songs this morning. Join together with me now in this opening prayer. We bless your holy name, O God, for all your servants who, having finished their course, now rest from their labors. Give us grace to follow the example of their steadfastness and faithfulness to your honor and glory through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Sometimes it's good to do some of our traditional things, and this morning, let us recite together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. And in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. It's appropriate at this time to follow that up with the Gloria Patri. Sing along. Listen now to the Old Testament lesson for today from the book of Ruth, chapter 3, verses 1 through 5, and 4, 13 through 17. Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to Ruth, "My daughter, I need to seek some security for you so that it may be well with you. Now here is our kinsman Boaz, with whose young women you have been working. See, he is winnowing barley tonight at the threshing floor. Now wash and anoint yourself and put on your best clothes and go down to the threshing floor, but do not make yourself known to the man until he has finished eating and drinking. When he lies down, observe the place where he lies, then go and uncover his feet and lie down, and he will tell you what to do. She said to her, "All that you tell me, I will do." So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. And when they came together, the Lord made her conceive, and she bore a son. Then the woman said to Naomi, "Blessed be the Lord who has not left you this day without next of kin, and may his name be renowned in Israel. He shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age. For your daughter-in-law, who loves you, who is more to you than seven sons, has borne him." Then Naomi took the child and laid him to her bosom and became his nurse. The women in the neighborhood gave him a name, saying, "A son has been born to Naomi." They named him Obed. He became the father of Jesse, the father of David. The epistle lesson for today is from the book of Hebrews, chapter 9, 24 through 28. For Christ did not enter a sanctuary made by human hands, a mere copy of the true one, but he entered into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. Nor was it to offer himself again and again, as the high priest enters the holy place year after year with blood that is not his own. For then he would have had to suffer again and again since the foundation of the world. But as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the age to remove sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for mortals to die once, and after that the judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him.
Jesus denounces the scribes. As he taught, he said, "Beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and to have the best seats in the synagogues and places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses and for the sake of appearance say long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation. The Widow's Offering. He sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in 2 small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then he called his disciples and said to them, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on."
We Methodists aren't much on saints. Oh, we joke about St. Peter at the door of the pearly gates and how he has to pick and choose who comes in. That idea was maybe put forth by Dante in one of his literary writings. Peter was the first pope, and maybe that's where it came from. And the jokes are good, like this one. A minister dies and is waiting in the line at the pearly gates. Ahead of him is a guy who's dressed in sunglasses, a loud shirt, a leather jacket, and jeans. St. Peter addresses this guy, "Who are you? So that I may know whether or not to admit you into the kingdom of heaven." And the guy replies, "I'm Joe Cohen, tax driver of New York City." So St. Peter consults his list and he smiles and says to the taxi driver, "Take this silken robe and golden staff and enter the kingdom of heaven." And the taxi driver goes into heaven with his robe and his staff, and it's the minister's turn. He stands erect and he booms out, "I am Joseph Snow, pastor of Calvary for the last 43 years. St. Peter consults his list. He says to the minister, "Take this cotton robe and wooden staff and enter the kingdom of heaven." "Just a minute," says the minister. "That man was a taxi driver and he gets a silken robe and a golden staff. How can this be?" "Up here, we work by results," said St. Peter. "While you preached, people slept. While he drove, people prayed." But we Methodists, we're not much on saints. The Catholics are, however. When Ryan and Missy were trying to sell their house, Missy told us about burying a St. Joseph statue upside down in the dirt under the realtor's sign. St. Joseph was Mary's husband. Yeah, that Joseph. It is said that Joseph protected Mary and Jesus from danger, which often involved bad real estate sales. In the Catholic tradition, St. Joseph is known to be the patron saint of home and family. Over the years, this role has evolved to also include home sales and real estate. While no one knows who exactly started this tradition, it is said that the original intention about burying St. Joseph upside down in the dirt was to incentivize the saint to sell the home in order to turn him right side up. I don't know, but their house did eventually sell. Another cool saint story is about St. John Bosco. He had a zeal for saving souls, especially for the youth who came to find work in Turin, Italy, St. John's hometown. Working wherever he could, Bosco provided boys with education, religious instruction, and recreation. Eventually, he headed a large establishment containing a grammar school, a technical school, and a church, all built through his efforts. In order to attract the attentions of the young of the city, he mastered many unpriestly skills, such as juggling or acrobatics or magic tricks. His reputation grew among the young boys in Turin, Italy, where he taught them, lived with them, and helped them lead happier, holier lives. His methods were a bit unorthodox, which led a few of his fellow priests to recommend John to the insane asylum. When the priests came for him with horse and carriage, John Bosco knew of their intentions. He politely waited as the 2 priests entered into the carriage, and when it was his turn to step on, he slammed the door, slapped the horse, and yelled to the carriage driver, "To the asylum! They're expected!" John went on to found the Salesian Order, also known as the Society of St. Francis de Sales. His feast day is January 31st, a day to honor a pioneer in education for the poor. But we Methodists are not much on saints. John Wesley liked the idea of All Saints Day, calling it a comfortable day. An odd description, perhaps. The Catholics believe that saints help us grow closer to God. They believe the saints are mediators between us and God. We Methodists think that that job was totally taken care of by Christ. We Methodists recognize Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John and other early followers of Jesus as saints, but we also call other people saints because they exemplify the Christian life. In this sense, every Christian can be considered a saint. And when we say he's a saint for what he did, we don't mean we need a statue of him and place it on the kitchen windowsill or out in the garden. And today, if we look carefully at the four lectionary readings for this morning, maybe there are some saintly activities we can hold on to. First, Naomi and Ruth's story. What a love story that book is. First, the daughters-in-law love Naomi enough for them to say they will stay with her forever. That's lovely, and it's love. Ruth does stay with Naomi, but then Naomi has the burden of making sure Ruth will not live alone and in poverty. Naomi hatches the plan for Ruth to end up married to the good man Boaz. It's a great story. Go ahead sometime and read the whole book of Ruth. And lo and behold, their son is born. Obed, their son, is the grandfather of David. Cool, huh? Naomi isn't a saint, but she is caring, and she looks out for her daughter-in-law in a loving manner. She nurtures Obed once he is born, making sure he's loved and cared for, and Boaz, once he marries Ruth, is not unlike a saint, as his marriage to her saves her, literally and figuratively. His care for both Ruth and Naomi redeems their tragic lives. They would have been helpless and destitute after the loss of husbands and sons. But Boaz's marriage to Ruth ensures their futures. Saintly sort of behavior. And Ruth, her faithful love for Naomi, I will go where you go. I will live where you live. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. How faithful Ruth was to not leave her mother-in-law, who was both a widow and without children. So in the first story for this morning, we see the saintly qualities of love, redemption, nurturing, faithfulness. Secondly, there's the psalm. We used part of the psalm for the other parts of the service this morning, so you heard some of these lines. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. It is vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows, for so he gives his beloved sheep. Three things stand out in these short verses. Houses should be built with God in the mix. Guards aren't going to be the only thing needed in this world. We also need God. And getting up early and working all day, without God in your day, life isn't going to be easy. Surely God isn't a saint, he's God. But let's think about the suggestions and see where the saint part might fit in. Relying on the guidance of God, on the protection of God, and on the provision of God, those things are what the first three lines are about. Think about Paul, for example. Who better relied on God for everything? After his encounter with Jesus on the road to Damascus, he was totally sure that God was his God, that proclaiming the gospel of Jesus was his job, and that no matter what he went through, proclaiming Christ and Christ crucified, that was all that he wanted to do. No Methodist doubts that Paul had the qualities of a saint. The writer of Hebrews tells us that Christ will come again. He died once for our sins, and that no matter what we do, we can't take away our own sins. Christ already did that. Praise God, right? But not only did he take away our sins with his blood and body, which we will celebrate here in church today with the communion service, he also wants us to remember that our sins are forgiven. Forgiving isn't easy work to do. Not forgiving ourselves, and not forgiving others. And when you think about it, there can be a conflict when someone says to you, I forgive you. That conflict might come if we are quite convinced we did nothing that needed forgiving. But a spirit of forgiveness, that's a saintly quality. And finally, the woman who put her money in the church treasury box. She gave all she had. She gave out of her poverty. None of us would say that Jesus's respect for her was ill-placed. She gave all. Jesus, above all others, knows what it's like to give all. Her gratefulness for the Lord and what he did for her was the encouragement she needed to be generous, very generous, for his glory. Oh, if we were all like that, there would be no end to the money we would be able to send out these doors in mission work. No end. And generosity and gratitude, saintly qualities. So today, even though we don't honor St. John Bosco or St. Peter at the Pearly Gates or even St. Joseph or St. Francis, we honor in grateful remembrance the people in our lives who have passed on, who have gone home to Jesus. For each of them, we remember their good qualities that made them valuable people in our lives. And for sure, someday our names will be among those who have lived and died. And when those days come, it will be a happier day for those we leave behind when they can say, "She was such a saint," or "Wasn't he a saint?" Let it be so. Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you that you use our very minds and bodies to accomplish your purposes in this world. We call to mind the ones who went before us, and we remember them and their work for your kingdom. We call to mind the ones coming who will build upon the dreams and deeds that you have begun through us. Give us the grace to teach our children to know the Lord so that your heritage will continue through them. Build our homes and communities with strong foundations of great faith and peace that will outlast us and sustain those who come after us. We do not merely look to law enforcement and elected officials to watch over us, but we ask that you set a guard over our towns and villages. We will not live to see the results of all the promises that you have made, nor will we see the fruit of the seeds we have sown. But the saints that went before us were not daunted by the work they did to get us here. So we will work for your kingdom here on earth. Merciful God, we wait with a blessed hope that you will send others who will build upon our dreams and deeds to the glory of your name. Some of the saints before us were workers who cared for the sick and sorrowful. They preached and taught, they served and were prayer warriors. We ask you, Jesus, to show us how to do the same for the ones who are struggling this day. And some of the saints, God, were able to inspire because of the joy and gratitude they show day in and day out. We too feel joy and gratitude, God, for the many blessings in our lives. Thank you, Eternal Father. You have blessed us today. You bless us every day that we turn to you. And we turn to you now with the prayer your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If by chance you are a regular viewer of our YouTube church services and would like to support us financially, the addresses for both of our churches are on the screen. We would appreciate any donation so that we can continue the missions of both churches. Thank you so much. This final hymn this morning is one of the classics for All Saints Sunday, and it's called For All the Saints. and now this benediction. God's people have celebrated all that God has done, from creation to the cross to the saints who have lived among us. Now we go from this place to the workplace, the home place, the marketplace, every place, living as God's own people. And may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. We continue our worship that started last week with our new postlude for the month, I Love You, Lord.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, O my soul, rejoice. Joy, my King, in what you hear, make it a sweet, sweet sound in your soul demand.